So thanks, thanks. I know it's almost end of the event, and we have the panel here. Great to have Ms. Archana Ramakrishnan, Director and the Head of Innovations, Conduent Labs. And then we have Ms. Sukriti, Jalali, she's the Head of Blockchain and IoT at TCS. And we have Mr. Avinash Pitti, who's the CTO of Nucleus Vision. And let me start with a quick round of introduction. We'll ask Archana to give a quick introduction of yourself and the Conduent.
Sure. Can you hear me? Is this audible?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. Thanks, Munir. Thanks, to, I'm happy to be here and good to see the participation towards the end of the session. I head the Conduent Labs, which is part of the larger Conduent organization. Conduent, many of you may not know, is a large BPS or a business process services organization. What we do is we do a lot of the back office operations across diverse industries, from healthcare to transportation to retail, and we manage contact centers, of course. We manage their finance and accounting processes. We manage their human resource services. Largely our client base is based out of Europe and US. Conduent Labs, Conduent is a company was a spin-off from Xerox, and many of you may know Xerox and Xerox Labs. So Conduent Labs was moved over with Conduent. We continue in the same spirit of research and development for the larger business process services organization. Where our current focus is on emerging technologies. We look at artificial intelligence, of course. We look at ML, statistics. We work on NLP. We work on computer vision. IoT and blockchain is something new that we sort of started off with. We're still exploring the space, very honestly. And a lot of our work is on providing solutions and incubating new ideas, running them through proof of concepts and pilots, and then establishing the validity of new technologies and new algorithms back to our main business partners. So that's my introduction.
Thank you, Ms. Archana. Dr. Sukriti.
Hi all, this is Sukriti. So I'm part of TCS, Tata Consultancy Services. I think most of you would be aware of it. It's part of the larger Tata group. And I head the blockchain and IoT and emerging technologies for one of the business units in TCS, which is called the high-tech business unit. So primarily, we focus on helping our customers, which are in the OEM space, computer platforms, software product companies, professional services companies, embark on their digital initiatives, especially with a focus on IoT, blockchain, and emerging technologies. Thanks.
Thanks.
Thank you. My name is Avinash Pitti. I'm CTO, Nucleus Vision. We have our booth outside. Basically, we work on blockchain and IoT and AI solution for personalizing consumer experience while the consumer walks into the store. So it's a whole platform of capturing the consent, capturing the person, and then serving the customer with a better experience while people walk into the store for shopping. So the current sector that we have chosen is retail, but then there is a future request in different industries as well.
Thank you, Nish. So this panel, we have a unique thing, which is basically looking into both blockchain and IoT, right? So both are pretty hot and emerging technologies. So to start with, in the earlier session, we talked about some of the standard that's being developed on the IoT and blockchain common framework or architecture that's been developed, and it's a good opportunity for me that my panel is also about that. So to start with, I would like to ask, what are the use cases wherein IoT, why do you want to club IoT, blockchain along with IoT, which is, what are those things which cannot be done without, or it can be done better by clubbing with clubbing IoT projects with blockchain. I keep it open for anybody to pick it up.
Yeah, I can take it up. I think, in fact, so yesterday we had a presentation of best practices for IoT and blockchain. There are like so many companies who are implementing blockchain and IoT. Specific use cases, it could be many. I would start with a fact that not everything should go on the blockchain when it comes to IoT, and there's so much huge amount of data. It's only what is absolutely required. So some of the use cases, it could vary from supply chain to healthcare to even tech, security perspective. There's some very, very specific use cases, even in supply chain or even in retail. So what we do is we capture the consent of a customer. We don't put in all the data that we capture. It's absolutely not required to have a blockchain solution for that. But the idea is you identify a use case where you want to say, I authenticate the device. I check the authorization of the device or the sender. I want to make sure that the communication is secure and there is data, analytics, whatever you want to do outside of it. So I would leave more stuff for others. I can keep on talking for this, but.
Yeah, so blockchain is mostly, I mean, it's a distributed ledger, right? So ultimately, it's a storage system kind of, which has special characteristics, right? And what IoT brings in is the real-time data into it, real-time visibility into what is happening outside of blockchain. It can build, you know, bring in provenance into it, saying what is the source, what is the destination, what happened where, right? The ledger itself doesn't know anything, right? It is just a storage system. So you need those elements, whether it's trust, whether it's real-time auditability, whether it's tracking of things, whether it's bringing external events, which you can validate, right? And you want only the right data to flow into your blockchain systems. You don't want wrong data to flow into them. And so IoT plays a very crucial role there, and actually it's predicted most of the blockchain applications will have an IoT integration with them. At least 70-80% should have. You of course have non-IoT blockchain use cases also. But if you're talking about visibility, you know, chain of custody kind of things, permanence, traceability, you need to connect it to data which is coming from outside of your network.
I think we've covered most of the points. So, I mean, I can talk about some of the applications that are currently in use, maybe. Some of the use cases primarily are in supply chain, as both Avinash and Sukriti have already talked about. For instance, I think many of you may already be aware of this food traceability, right? I think particularly Walmart, which has really touted this use case. And how do I verify that where does my single input come from, or my, for instance, where does my meat come from, or where is it sourced from? And also the other main angle is in what temperature-controlled environment has the meat been transported from my farm to my store, right? At the end of the day, so that's one of the more prevalent use cases there. We look at using sensors to detect the temperature that's on these containers as they pass through these shipping environments, and whether they are actually maintaining the temperature at the right environment, so that your meat doesn't get contaminated when it actually gets to your hand. So this is one of the more live use case, if you will, which has actually been implemented to some extent. And many of them, how do I trace my diamonds back to my source, or how do I, look at my ownership of my paintings, or especially luxury goods, for instance. So these are primarily some of the more prevalent use cases. And so traceability, of course, becomes a key access point or value point when it comes to blockchain and IoT. Apart from how do I also maintain the identity of these devices, right? Security, see, I think blockchain, the core concept of why we think of blockchain and IoT is one of the questions that, when we look at IoT is what kind of security does it have? So blockchain can act as an enabler to enhance that security aspects of IoT as well.
Thanks. So, looking at the applications and you know the vast I think you're sharing like 70 to 80% of the use cases that can be integrated with the blockchain. Now, how easily or seamlessly can we onboard IoT devices in a blockchain? You know, and can blockchain help help this automate in onboarding the IoT devices?
So a lot of things today, you have the digital flow of things, right? And then you have the physical flow of things. So in the real world, physical and digital don't meet, right? I mean, you could have a truck going somewhere, but you, unless you capture the real time parameters from it, you don't know whether the physical good of movements matches the actual digital flow of movements, right? So that's why you have all these digital systems in place today. Specifically, how can it address IoT devices onboarding, right? So today, if you know, if you have to put in an IoT device, and of course it varies from industry to industry, a retail industry could be different, an enterprise, a manufacturing plant could be different. There are different, but the idea is that the IoT devices are just exploding, right? You have maybe 30 million next year, and then they're predicting 70 million in the field. So how do we manage all of them, right? You have legacy devices, you have OEMs who have actually put their keys into this, but now they're no longer supporting it. You have versions where the Linux itself has some vulnerability and nobody has gone and updated those devices. So there's a lot of things there that are there in the field which you need to keep on upgrading because you have new security flaws and new paradigms emerging every day in the cybersecurity space. And especially it's these devices that are prone, that are used by hackers, like the bot attacks and stuff like that. They look at those vulnerabilities. So today, how you enable a device in the field is you have the PSKs, right, the pre-shared keys, which the OEMs put in the factory, and then you have a way of authenticating it over some network with your end server. And it essentially involves sharing of certificates, which is again not the best way to do it because these devices are resource constrained. Decentralized systems can help is, of course, everything can have a unique identity, right? So the whole digital and unique identity itself can help there. And because you have a way of now decentralizing your policies and who can do what update when. You have a visibility into where your device is at what point of time, what exactly is the firmware, right? So the visibility itself and the way of then percolating down your new firmware to your new upgrades, your new policies, who can do the upgrades. And maybe you also delegate how these devices can be upgraded going forward, right? It's not just the OEM who will do it. It's not just the service provider who will do it. But you have a mechanism through your consensus, whatever features a blockchain provides today to ensure that everything gets kind of grounded into the field. It can be deployed, right? So I think it has a role to play.
I would leave it to the tech expert.
Okay, there, I'll take it up. So absolutely. You want to continue?
I think unless there's a question.
See, I think I was first giving a chance because I spoke last. So I would be really careful in terms of what I put on the blockchain. As the numbers, the projections say, so by 2025, we'll have about 75 billion devices projected. Connected devices, so 10 times the population, I'm sure, 8 times the population of those. So very, very serious in terms of understanding what I want on the chain. I am not registering all the 75 billion devices. I have to be very particular about identifying the use case which requires detailed authentication. If I have to authenticate the source, if I have to authenticate the sender, if I have to authenticate what type of data flows, as she mentioned about security. Let's take an example of a nuclear facility, I think we were discussing, of triggers, alarms, temperature controlled elements. I would be it is a very sensitive trigger when it comes to data being. I'm sure there are a lot of alert mechanisms otherwise, but there are IoT-based alert mechanisms. So it's very important. We identify, we register, we secure, and we use those devices and use blockchain only for specific, even in IoT use cases.
And you have an upcoming trend of peer-to-peer. Devices can talk to devices, right? They don't even need to go to a central network. So in that case, it becomes even more crucial when you are leaving the communication to two devices. You have to ensure they are up to date in terms of what they can do and how they act. So I think having those unique identifiers, ensuring the system is up to date, blockchain can play a lot of role.
The second part of this question is like, you know, can blockchain, like there are two challenges, right? When one is bringing these IoT devices onto the blockchain. We all know that there are issues or, you know, the challenges that we face in configuring these IoT devices. And, you know, is there a way that blockchain can blockchain help in when there are so many devices out there? Can it help in configuring these IoT devices? Is that something that doable? How do you think?
Yes.
I just want to add that, you know, yes, onboarding of devices and configuration of devices today is still a very intensive process. I mean, cloud providers do say that in one touch, one click of a button, and you can quickly onboard your devices, etc. But it continues to have manual inputs of, you know, which devices are you using and how do I register with your registry, and so on and so forth. And in respect to the configuration, I believe, there are aspects of, your device configuration itself being stored on the blockchain that could essentially, you know, help whether, you know, if the device, let's say, needs a firmware update or it needs to be reset for some reason. Can I reuse the, you know, the last known configuration maybe on my blockchain to sort of, download that and then update my device at the end of the day, right? So, that's one way of providing security to the device itself, because tomorrow I know if that device has been tampered, I would have that identity on my blockchain to figure out that this is not the right device that I need to be talking to, right? So that is it's again adding to the security aspects of your blockchain or your IoT device itself. But yes, I mean, there are some aspects of, you know, how do I use blockchain to store my configuration so that I can easily retrieve it at a later point in time.
And it's also easier to isolate rogue devices. You'll not bring down the whole network. Like in a centralized network, it's very easy to replicate that error, right? But if it's a consensus-based something which you have coded, and it'll not bring your whole network down because it's all decentralized. And you can actually quickly identify the fault, you can isolate it quickly, and ensure that you are no fault tolerant in that sense, and it's free.
No, very good.
I think that's very important that you mentioned about the security and, you know, how it can help. I know, like, one of the biggest concern on the IoT systems is the security, and blockchain being the most secure. So the marriage between those two.
I think you don't have to look at specific features, that onboarding or firmware update. You have to look at the whole device life cycle and then say, no, it could be blockchain, it helps, maybe AI helps, maybe something else helps. But essentially, the whole IoT device life cycle, there's a lot of gaps today in the industry. And actually, the IETF Foundation, they are now coming up with a standard to ensure that the whole life cycle of a device is secure, which will include many of these parameters and technologies to enable that. So
you have something, the standard for IEEE IoT.
Yeah.
If you throw lights on how.
Yeah, we did talk about a lot on the stand. Basically, my whole session was there on the standards on the blockchain and IoT that's out there in IEEE. That's a work in progress. It's an active project that's there. If anybody wants to have a look at it or be part of it, it's IEEE P2418.1. You can join this particular working group and see what's happening, and you can contribute towards it. Even if you're not an expert, just want to be observer, that's also fine. thanks for bringing that up. So when you think, see that, you know, all these advantages, why do you see that, you know, I still do not see, you know, blockchain getting into the mainstream, right? You know, so what do you think, what are the hiccups or what are the challenges that are out there for blockchain not being accepted or not being in the mainstream?
So, I mean, yes and no. One, I think there are about 6% projects live. So definitely it needs more adoption. Two, there is still, at the government level, at the provenance level, regularization, if you look at the technology as to what it provides, right? Definitely there is increase in demand in terms of understanding the technology, how it can be implemented. There are so many use cases government is adopting to do POCs. Commercial stages, yes, it's taking time. People are playing this waiting game. We are definitely not talking about any of the cryptocurrencies, but it's the blockchain as a technology to prove decentralization, how it will help specific use cases. Like, we know Dubai government is trying to evaluate land registry. We have in India, the government of Telangana, Assam, Goa, like big protocols. Even in India, I've seen, I think 1101 is also doing some POCs for different companies. So it is taking time. It is not far when we see real adoption in terms of commercial execution. I know of a company who is doing, who is entering into some commercial stages on an execution on blockchain in the state of Andhra. So there is like where you track rice supply chain execution. But otherwise, it is not far when we see real adoption in blockchain as a technology for usage. No comments on crypto, but certainly we have a lot of interests. We are seeing a lot of initiatives coming from different parts of India and across the world. And I think we are taking references and learning from international, where talk about cities like Zug in Switzerland, and there is like different countries showing and leading this practice for adoption. So the more we talk about blockchain, yes, we want it. We want to show the value. There are scalability issues, everybody knows. But I think solutions, researchers, everybody's trying to solve the problem of scalability, which it itself, I think, is commendable.
So, I mean, I completely agree with all his points, right? So I would also like to add that I think from an enterprise perspective, right, if you look at organizations coming together, that is a huge problem. How do I get all my, I mean, we worked with some of the large OEMs trying to get them to figure out if blockchain can actually improve the procurement process. We manage the procurement process, and we wanted to use blockchain as a way to, you know, manage that entire process and make sure, because they get a number of invoices, they get a number of a lot of suppliers coming into the picture, and you know, it's a prime use case when it comes to actual blockchain adoption, right? But you know, there is a lot of change management that's necessarily involved when you talk about adopting a new technology, especially when an enterprise. I mean, these are large OEMs which have been existent for like, you know, decades. So I think you know, you need that champion in that industry to sort of, you know, set the tone forward in some sense, especially in the enterprise use case, saying that okay, I think the shipping company, I guess Maersk, is now doing a good job of getting that you know, all of those ports and all of those you know, participants coming together, and they are championing that entire effort, right? So similarly, I think you need these large organizations to also champion the effort in some sense, to mandate in some sense that their suppliers come onto the same network and they are able to communicate with each other. Otherwise, there is that element of why should I trust a technology, right, at the end of the day? Although we are saying it's a, you know, you trust the technology, rather I might as well do this manually, right? So I think that's one, also one, you know, one reason to sort of lag behind some of these enterprise adoptions, but nevertheless, I think if one of them come forward and actually prove a live, you know, actual use case, I think there'll be much more better adoption. Because given the technology is still immature to that extent.
Do you think that, you know, regularization would help or? You know?
Yeah, I mean, I think it will go the regulatory path today or tomorrow. China government has endorsed it. U.S. government has endorsed. India is still finding the cyber laws to address the smart contracts and stuff like that. So ultimately, it will go. But I don't think that is kind of deterring people from innovating and trying out what blockchain can do. I also think you have to give it time, right? I mean, from the time TCP, IP, and internet came to the time we had e-commerce, there was a huge number of decades, right? It's not instantly. So from the time IBM computer came to the time we had a PC in our home, it took a couple of years, right? And even IoT adoption took its own sweet time. Now it's prevalent. You have to give it time. It's a technology which is disruptive. Maybe the killer use case is still not defined, right? We're just trying to retrofit existing use cases. And I think the future is, it's only going to grow because that's what we've seen in the last 3-4 years. We didn't have production level deployments. We didn't have MVPs. We have that today. People are deploying it at production levels. You have people coming together, whether it's a consortium or different companies working together, because it's a win-win for everyone, right? So I'm quite bullish on it, and I'm sure it will kind of grow from where it is today.
Thank you. I think we should open up this for questions from the audience here. If anybody has any questions out there, at the first I saw the hand all the way at the back, and then we have the gentleman here in the green shirt.
Hi, good evening. My name is Anush. We all understand that a blockchain can store information in a publicly verifiable and immutable manner. However, this information that the blockchain stores, it obtains from these IoT devices. So what happens in case an IoT device starts malfunctioning or is feeding the wrong information to the blockchain? How does one possibly identify that the wrong information has been fed, and then how do you correct it, versus how do you identify, say, in a supply chain scenario where you're tracking food, that the IoT device actually ended up recording the wrong temperature while the food item was actually still preserved, and you ended up discarding the item?
So to answer that question, one, it's a ledger. You write whatever it is, it's written. It's not like you can change it, you can manipulate it, right? So if I say I write 10 degrees instead of 5 degrees, it's not blockchain's problem. It's the data which is being transmitted from the IoT to the chain. So that's problem. That's one security. Two, you can set in some contracts where you can trigger some alerts. When I say rule, so maybe you can come up with a rule engine based on the temperature control or based on the process where if the recording of the data or if there is any specific alert that you would want to trigger based on any malfunction or any wrong sending of data, you just have to trigger the right mechanism to escalate. But blockchain internally, when you write something, there is no way that it will do it by itself. It's that rule engine that you have to come up with in every use case where the security of the IoT device has to be audited. That way you have the right escalation process based on any malfunction. Now, if the device goes bad, if the device is stopped, there is no way that what you put on the ledger has to do with, I mean, you can check and authenticate all the data on what data is going, who is writing it, and all that. But once you write it, once you submit a transaction and it's validated on the block, I think we're done. Next is, if there is a conflict, then there has to be a proper escalation process. This is what I feel.
Yeah, so it's a combination of tech. That's why we focus on the business use case. What are you trying to solve, right? So maybe IoT alone could solve it. Maybe IoT and blockchain could solve. Maybe IoT, blockchain, and you need an AI engine to predict things and do something if the readings are not right. But the important thing is that blockchain helps you trace that and fix liabilities on someone who has done what, right? So for instance, in the case of a supply chain, if you're transferring drugs, for instance, now even if there's a faulty reading, right, now who is liable? Is it the logistic player? Is it the driver who's responsible? Is it the company who manufactured that sensor? Are they responsible? Is the company who's transferring goods responsible? Is the insurance company liable? So there are a lot of parties that get involved. And this helps you at least trace and put liabilities on the people who should be owning that, right?
My name is Pankaj. I just wanted to ask, so what has your experience been in which blockchain frameworks are more suited to use with IoT? Is it more like the blockless ones like Tangle, or is there a case for the other frameworks also? Given that with IoT, there'll be multiple feeds that are coming in. It's not necessarily in a particular sequence you need to use them, right? So what's your experience with those?
See, I would be one very careful in terms of the amount of data that is being stored. As of now, I think enterprise solution where we have a private blockchain, you store, for example, we have built a testnet where we had a million blocks created in terms of the number of transactions to test how we can scale. I mean, not commenting on what TPS I had, how many transactions I'm storing per second, and all that, but I think in terms of an experience that we currently are undergoing in terms of scalability or in terms of private blockchain that we are currently using. We are seeing a good TPS. I think we have currently used and created a blockchain based on Raft and IPFT where, so again, when it comes to IOTA or its Tangle technology of how you store unlimited limitless transactions and stuff, but I think as of now, a private blockchain, enterprise level blockchain or a private blockchain, seeing more scalability. Public blockchains obviously has this gas issues, cost issues, but certainly I think private ones or an enterprise ones would be currently suitable. Again, those are also not, might not be enough to justify the demand for, let's say, 30 billion IoT devices today. But I would certainly go into a direction of a private blockchain and not specifically look, because IOTA also is still evolving. If you look at their the graph process or the way the validation works, I think it's still evolving, but I would certainly go into a direction, specifically for IoT, I would say that a private blockchain with a limited required set of nodes as of now to meet the current demand.
Thanks, Avinash.
There's one on the top, sir.
All right, this and then the last one on the top, I think we are already running out of time here.
It's always, it's time up.
Yeah, it says time.
Hello everyone, Shivam here. I have a question. We are seeing different private blockchains working for different sectors right now. So do you feel see a future where we will have different private blockchains working, or a single blockchain and on the top of it is smart contracts working and dApps created for different use cases? How do you see the future?
So it depends. I think in maybe the B2C space, like for instance land records, maybe you could have more open government-led blockchains which are more open. But in the enterprise space, it's all private blockchains. And private blockchains, again, you could host the nodes on different clouds, right? Some node can be on Azure, one can be on Bluemix, third can be on-prem, fourth can be, you know, so the multi-cloud, multi-hybrid kind of environment will exist. And slowly, I think you'll have verticalized use cases, right? Maybe for financial, like R3 Corda is good in some cases, Ripple is good in, you know, cross-border payments, supply chain, again, you'll have verticalized. So you have a lot of these sub-verticalized platforms, use cases, and then the whole ecosystem. Yeah.
See, to add on to that, I think, one, there is definitely interoperability to work on. If you look at some protocols who are currently collaborating with, let's say, Government of Telangana and Government of Andhra, they have dApps built on it. Yes, and there are different layer solutions also coming up where it's platform agnostic. There are solutions where if you, I mean, there's like everybody's trying to say, oh, I have cracked a deal with the government of Andhra for a rice distribution blockchain solution, and somebody says that I've cracked a deal and we are doing a POC with somebody. For sure, it is about how you get into an early adoption phase, but at the same time, there needs to be a proven solution for interoperability where you collaborate and understand how different consensus are working together in terms of me working with your protocol and how these dApps will be cross-functional. So it will take time, but yes, there will, in the course of time, you will see that these different blockchains are working together and these dApps will also work on different blockchains.
Hi, so just want to check, so you are saying about private blockchain, but I want to know which particular blockchain is preferred by enterprise customers. Like for example, if Archana and Sukriti can say, which particular blockchain is preferred by customers for implementation, whatever POC and deployment you are doing. Like there are multiple options, right? You have Coda, you have this
Hyperledger
and Microsoft has Quorum as Ethereum Quorum in their cloud. But where is the trend? Which particular thing is preferred by customers, real world implementation happening in the enterprises?
So, I mean, I think it's both ways, right? Many corporates or enterprises are particularly not aware of which is the right blockchain for them, very honestly. But there are, of course, enlightened organizations as well who sort of prefer certain, primarily because they believe that, because they are part of a consortium already or because their peers are already part of a consortium and they want to be part of those similar blockchains. So it's, in my view at least, it's there is not a one-stop solution, especially from the enterprise perspective. Primarily, I think financial organizations largely prefer Corda at this point in time. When you ask them why, they may not give you the right answers. They may not even answer you correctly as to why they need it. They just need it, right? We've been talking to a lot of enterprises on Hyperledger primarily because that I think when it comes to actual deployment and development, we want to have a community that supports some of these deployments at the end of the day, right? We don't want unproven technologies, especially in an enterprise setting, or completely unproven. I mean, I'm not saying everything is unproven. So, I mean, those are some of the considerations when you look at which blockchain you would want to go. But primarily, I think Hyperledger, Corda, the at least from my experience, has been largely preferred by enterprises. It depends on the use case, of course. You know, what are you using? I think there was also, forget the name of that platform, but one of the other platforms which we were touting. But
Quorum is there. Yeah.
See, I think to add to that, sorry, I interrupted. I think Hyperledger claims about 2,000 TPS. When somebody is trying to sell a solution, they ask, oh, how many transactions do you expect per second? And based on that, they try to propose a solution because these service providers, they all care about, obviously, business, serving the client and meeting the client's requirements. If the requirement says that, oh, I am a port of Vishakhapatnam and I expect so many transactions to happen in terms of volume, then the solution, the requirement changes. But Hyperledger claims to have about 2,000 TPS, but when you, we did this small test of how we test the 2,000 TPS, you do multi-scale, it is shown, we can find this information online about when you scale to multiple nodes, the TPS comes down with the multi-node. Quorum, on the other side, talks about 100 TPS. I mean, we have seen on the previous talk, Bitcoin and Ethereum has about 7 to 10 TPS, and there's no point of saying I have 2,000, 5,000, 10,000 TPS with so many nodes. So Quorum, on the other hand, says that I'll try and justify 100 TPS, and then with scale, it comes down. So it is time that we will see better solutions, we will see scalability improvement solutions with multiple nodes. One node, two nodes, it doesn't justify my claim of having 1,000 or 2,000 TPS. So we need to do a thorough test of what is the right solution for me. That is why I think all of these POCs are being executed by departments where they see what is the right solution for me in terms of scale. I mean, you cannot say I'll have 10 million transactions with 100 nodes or 1,000 nodes. So there's no one answer to that, as she rightly said, but it also depends on some of these attributes which define the requirements of the clients and also core expertise of the people who are proposing it. So you were saying something, I stopped.
No,
you.
That's okay.
Yeah. Hi, this is Lakshman. Given the scenario, like we are having a lot of many emerging technologies coming up, IoT, blockchain, AI, ML, are these technologies going to replace the existing technologies, or how is it? How do you predict, or how do you foresee down the line?
They're going to coexist, especially if you talk blockchain. Nobody's saying you do away with the legacy systems or existing systems, right? It's just where you want to add what. If you want to add maybe visibility into your processes, maybe you add IoT data. If you want to enable trust between two parties, which are not trusting today, maybe you look at blockchain, right? So AI ML is everywhere. You cannot kind of ignore it today. But they're kind of going to enhance what you're already doing, aiding your existing processes, and nobody's saying, you know, anything will get replaced by everything. But it's all an addition to, because you want visibility, you want traceability, you want trust to be, so essentially it's removing all the frictions that are there in your processes today. So that's where the technology play is coming.
Sorry, I have one very important point to add to that. Microsoft does not touch two of their businesses. No matter what you do with their cloud, what you do with their new platforms, they say, I'm not touching my operating system, I'm not touching my Office solution. So whether it is built on C language or C++ language or any of the old languages, even IBM says that I'll work on my mainframe solutions because there are hundreds and thousands of clients who are using still mainframe solutions. So whatever is proven is not going anywhere. Yes, there will be enhancements and better ways to present it, because I know that they are trying to move. There is a lot of switching cost, right? When it comes to a company, a $100 million company running a solution on mainframes, and now they're trying to move it, it's very, very difficult. So it's not. Yes. So nobody is replacing an existing technology, but you have to understand, if you don't evolve, today if you come and say me, I'll work on C++, I'll only work because Bitcoin is coded in C++, I'll work on C++, I might not have a defined requirement for you. I'm just saying, the evolution, even in terms of technology, I mean, if you see migration, when you talk about migration, Facebook acquired WhatsApp, but still they're still evolving, there's still integrations happening. There were two airlines in US being merged, and it took about 4 or 5 years for merging and migration project. So over the course of time, yes, it will evolve, and you have to evolve yourself for sure, but it's not like you will lose. I mean, a lot of us, I think technical people, we started with COBOL, C, but those programming concepts are still there. You know, if it's Java, it's public static void, man, it's still there. So it's not going anywhere, it's just adding on top of what you know. So I think,
some elements, yeah, just to add. So they've become like de facto, right? Being intelligent, being on the cloud, being smart, right? Being automated. So, I mean, everything is moving towards that. That's how the world is changing. So our technologies also follow that graph, right? Whatever is now on the cloud, what is getting automated, you have AI, ML, right? It's everything is moving in that paradigm. So that's how it will be.
I think it is important with the number of transactions to start posting it. It's not defined by the number of nodes, but it's defined on the number of transactions. You say 2,000 TPS, but as and when you start posting it, the thing comes down. So it depends on the amount of data that you capture or the data that you want to post it. I mean, if you look at, somebody evaluating on multi-chain, we can discuss about a few things offline if you want, but certainly, so many attributes defining the number of the what blockchain nodes and stuff.
I think certainly. I'm sure you know there are many more questions that people are enthusiastic and they know they want some answers from the panel here. And we have exceeded our time
yeah.
limit. So with that, I would really, and I'm sure, like you know, there are. It's not that you know this is the end of it. We'll have
of course, we are putting everything on the cloud, then there's a challenge of inter-cloud interoperabilities, right? You know, that's going to be there. You know, the challenges are going to be there, and looking at the interoperability between like existing and coexisting with multi technologies, and you know, so working with between the systems and between, you know, so that's the challenge, and I think that's where the market is also going to be if you want to have like, you know, a complete solution. And it's a challenge for everybody, and the more and more we think about interoperability and, you know, looking at it from a broader perspective, I think that's the key to go. With that, I would like to really thank the panelists here. You know,
I think I would like to thank Genesis Hack, Genesis DevCon, yep, for organizing a very good event.
Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you.
And also, I would like to thank all of you. You know, even though it's delayed, and we see quite a good number of participation and enthusiastic and having the questions here. Thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.